Let me welcome all of you to the second alumni event. My name is Peter Glick, and I'm a fourth-year clinical psychology doctoral student. And I'm here tonight representing our newly formed Alumni Steering Committee. I plan to keep my remarks brief, but I want to begin by thanking everyone for coming. And in particular, I want to thank our distinguished panel, Dr. Schlesinger, Shapiro, and Safran for appearing, and Mr. Charlie Rose for generously agreeing to moderate tonight's discussion. In keeping with tonight's theme of celebrating the legacy of our clinical psychology program, I think it's important to note the energy and enthusiasm buzzing throughout the room. In the audience, we have a remarkable collection of alumni, current students, faculty, and staff whose expertise, knowledge, and professionalism are rather incredible. I'm personally blown away that we've been able to attract so many of you here, and it's left me wondering how we've been able to do it. I mean, there's quite a few of you, and I think the answer is rather simple. I think it's pride. I think Charlie Rose also helps. But you know, seriously, I think every person here is proud to be associated with the New School's clinical psychology program. There's something distinctive and special about our training that binds us together. People genuinely feel special about this program. Whether you graduated 20 years ago, 10 years ago, or are still in training, we all share in the often unconventional and unique lineage of the program. And our hope is that tonight's discussion brings everyone home. Home to where your training began, where you first grappled in understanding clinical theory and struggled to find your therapeutic voice. Our home needs you, and by your attendance, I'm guessing you're happy to be home as well. With this in mind, our hope is that each of you continue to participate in various initiatives our committee is putting together. In the back of this room, we have some current students. We have Aslan Bakar and Ellie Newman Flegelman, who are hoping to have you sign up for various activities. We are not soliciting donations. Rather, our hope is that by combining your pride with the infrastructure we're creating, it will help you stay connected to the program and provide you with an opportunity to give something back in return, your time and your expertise. We're hoping to solicit alumni who are interested in supervising current students in different ways. Perhaps psychotherapy supervision, testing supervision, or mentoring students going through the internship application process. Or perhaps alumni just want to reconnect with each other. Some alumni have expressed an interest in creating peer supervision groups, so we're happy to help facilitate that process. Or perhaps you have other ideas or initiatives you'd like to create. Then I encourage you to join our Alumni Steering Committee. Our goal is to create an alumni network that is active, vibrant, dependable, and engaged. And to achieve that, we need your active participation. So please volunteer for one of the activities or feel free to contact me if you have other ideas you'd like to share. And with that, I'd like to bring to the podium a well-known and familiar face to the New School, particularly the psychology program, Dean and Professor of Psychology, Dr. Michael Schober.
Thank you, Peter, and welcome to everybody. It's a great pleasure to see so many familiar faces, and it's a pleasure to be part of the beginning of this kind of conversation among alumni of the clinical program. It's actually been a great pleasure for me to be part of this department and this program. It is an unusual thing for a non-clinician like me to be in a department with clinicians and to have colleagues who have been stimulating and challenging and have broadened my own thinking and been part of just a really unusual space. And so I really appreciate that. It makes sense that that would be at the New School, which is an unusual space on a larger scale. And so it's great that we have our quite distinguished panel who need no introduction, and therefore I will have to do a little bit of introducing of them. It is great that we have these three former directors of clinical training from this program. Clinical psychology has actually been at the New School since before they were here, and I remember an alum who got her experimental psychology PhD in 1957, who became a clinician thereafter, and talks about how that experimental training ended up influencing her clinical practice thereafter. And I know there was the connection with the Postgraduate Center for Mental Health, and there are former things that happened before. Here we have really the recent array of what has happened since 1984. Herb Schlesinger started as director of clinical training in 1984 until 1993. He is well, I think most of you know, does everybody here know him, probably? Is there anyone who doesn't? He was, you can talk about him as being the progenitor of what the program has become now. He is a fellow of the APA, honorary. He has a whole list of honors that we can talk about. He was the Alfred J. and Monette C. Merrow Professor of Psychology at the New School from 1984 on, and we will be hearing a lot about what he was up to during his time here. David Shapiro was Director of Clinical Training between 1996 and 2004. Both Herb and David are professors emeritus of psychology now in the department. David, you also needs no introduction. He received his doctorate from USC, has been chief psychologist of Austin Rigg Center, been at UCLA. His books, Psychotherapy of Neurotic Character and Autonomy of Rigid Character and Neurotic Styles, are well known to everyone here. So it'll be a great pleasure to hear from him as well. And then Jeremy Safran is professor of psychology here now, has been director of clinical training from 1993 to 1996, and then from 2004 to 2009. He came to us from Toronto, where he was director, first in Toronto, and then by way of Adelphi before, right? But he was director of the cognitive therapy unit at the Clark Institute of Psychiatry in Toronto, where he was also associate professor. And now I've lost the rest of it. Really? I really have. Okay. So, and Jeremy, well, he's well known to all of you here now because he's been the director for quite some time. And he's been succeeded by Miriam Steele now. But it is a great honor for us to have the three of them here to be able to recount the last several decades of what has gone on in the program. And then finally, another person who really needs no introduction is Charlie Rose. He's Emmy Award-winning journalist, and he's been praised as one of America's premier interviewers. He is host of the Charlie Rose, the nightly PBS program, that has been characterized as engaging the world's best thinkers, writers, politicians, athletes, entertainers, business leaders, scientists, and other newsmakers, and how terrific that directors of clinical training are now added to that list. USA Today calls Charlie Rose TV's most addictive talk show, and New York Newsday says, Charlie's show is the place to get engaging, literate conversation. Bluntly, he is the best interviewer around today. So we're extremely delighted to have him here, and let's start. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, my introduction this evening was from Dr. David Shapiro, who said to me, I know why I'm here, why are you here? And it's a very good question. But since I'm in the question business, I take great pride in that you said that. I'm here because I was asked to be here. I'll tell you a story about my profession and the story that I tell to all of my producers, and this goes a long, long time ago. There was a guy, young man who was an intern working for Arnold Gingrich, who was a late great editor of Esquire magazine, which was at that time really had a powerful place in the community. And this young intern was working there to him, and they were doing a story, and they needed a comment from General de Gaulle. And this was a story about General de Gaulle, and some of you may not even know who General de Gaulle is, but he was, if you're French, you do. And so the young, Arnold Gingrich said to the young intern, go get a quote from General de Gaulle. And the young intern said, well, of course, General de Gaulle is not going to talk to me. He's not going to give us a quote. What's wrong with you? To which Arnold Gingrich said to the young intern, let the general say no. Now, the point of that story is that someone said, why don't we have Charlie Rose come down, moderate this? And then someone, probably Georgina Hollick, who was one of your doctoral candidates, and said, my father knows him, and so therefore he's a friend of my father's, and why don't we ask him? And that was essentially the letter that note she sent me, and I said, I'm interested in psychology. I need psychology. I'm fascinated by the idea of what makes us human, and I'm fascinated by the idea of who I am, and that's part of the search that is part of what we do. You know, I'm also, as any of you who know my program, vitally interested in science. We did a long series last year, which my co-anchor was at, for this series, the then president of Rockefeller University, Dr. Paul Nurse, a Nobel laureate. Notice how I always reach upward for my co-host, because I'm now doing a series on the brain, and my co-host is another Nobel laureate, Eric Kandel. I bring that to your attention because of this one very, very important idea. Eric Kandel started life in Austria and started life as a professionally as a psychiatrist, very much influenced by Freud. And then he became, when he came to Columbia and NYU and other places, he became very, very interested in the idea of science and biology and where it was all going. He is enormously moved by the question. We have made this inquiry over a range of different people, from clinicians of great stature, and as well as the best biologists in the world who've come to do this series, which is now in its eighth episode. But we are, and have occasionally, we reach to this question of where is, on the one hand, biology and science, and where is, on the other hand, clinical behavior and all that's happening in your arena, you know, and we've tried to focus on where they're coming together. Now, I could be dramatically wrong, but I understand that that's part of what is what takes place here. So I'm here because someone asked me, I'm here because I'm interested in this, I'm here because if I am nothing else, I am someone who tries to find out more about what makes us tick. Journalists are about that, what makes us tick. And we need to reach into every realm of inquiry and scholarship and science to try to find that out. So when I use that as a way of beginning to say, my role here is simply to throw out some questions. I ask all of you, Dr. Shapiro especially, I'll say to you, you know, what I want you to do is engage, you know. The more you engage each other, the better off I am, because that means less work for me. And I'm tired, it's the end of my day, I've got a bad cold, so the more that you guys talk to each other, less for me. I'm happy to do this because I also believe the idea of a university and clinical psychology and a graduate program and bringing in the alumni and the idea of community is very important to an institution. So having said that, let me just have, I'll go first to here, to you, Dr. Schlesinger, and talk about, you know, the orientation of the program. What is the kind of the theoretical or the intellectual orientation of the graduate clinical psychology program? That's a big question. We'll be back in 30 minutes.
An easy question, which I have to say.
Now, what I'm going to do is ask you to use the microphone.
Truthful answer is I don't really know what the orientation is now, because I left this place in 1993.
But I had to start somewhere.
But more importantly, I didn't know what it was when I came. I bought a pig in a poke, as it were. I didn't find out what was here until I got here. And I found out, and it was an amazing place. It's everything everybody says about it. It's unique, and it combines the best of what I understood to be the European culture that Hitler fortunately chased out of Europe, and a lot of it lodged right here by accident, mostly history is made by the accidents, and a few that we didn't believe.
Yeah. Eric Kandel is one of those.
He was. And so was Mark Spearheim, and so was Canada.
Right, exactly.
And a bunch of other people who settled here. And now they continue to place at New School. I came because my wife at the time was tired of being in Colorado. Running down Main Street and not hit anybody after 8 o'clock. And I thought, I'm born here in New York, so And she went to Columbia, and at that point, Jerry Bruner, who was an old friend from Harvard and elsewhere, I know as a graduate student, called and asked if any of my students would be interested in running a clinical program here. We chatted about that, and he said, how about you? He says, well, it's not going to come to New York, let me take a look at it. So I took a cursory look at it, depending on Jerry's endorsement that it was a good place. stay long enough for me to scold him for that, but I found it was everything he said it was and much more. Now, the question was, what was the orientation? I'm not sure it had one at that time. The clinical program was very depleted in terms of the faculty, and I think it wanted to be psychoanalytic and dynamic in orientation, and that in a more broadly eclectic business. I think I was more impressed by the general faculty at that time because of outstanding people in it. And one thing that I was assured of, both from history and from my own experience, but the students here got a very strong background in general psychology. Mm-hmm. It was not a trade school for clinicians. And that appealed to me very much. And that's remained true. But I've been out in the field and seeing students trained at other schools, ours show up very, very well. They bring a background of science and critical thinking to their work, which is amazing because clinicians, by and large, are not known for critical thinking. But they're very strong belief structures. People tend to adhere to that and talk to their friends and not to talk to other people who don't share their beliefs. So it's a highly inbred, cultish kind of floor. And the training here, I think, has been opposed to that kind of development. Mm-hmm. I'm very pleased for that. So there's very little in psychology that can't be used with a dynamic point of view. And if you don't have a dynamic point of view toward any other thing you're doing, you have no point of view. Mm-hmm. That's what people are about. They have forces in them that move them. Mm-hmm. They have histories that they keep to relive over and over again. And the dynamic point of view is the point of view that dwells on that. And so that's essential. Whether you think of the psychopathology as something you learn or something inborn or whatever, doesn't matter. But it's lived according to the principles that Freud made clear, and its followers have made it clearer. Mm-hmm. And anyone else can contribute who has a voice in that process. So I think, by and large, the field has, the emphasis has remained so, but so far as I have any hand in it, it became eclectic in the best sense, that it borrowed from anybody who had anything reasonable to say, and pragmatic, and driven by science where there was appropriate science. And I think after we left for
good.
Afterwards for my colleagues.
All right. David?
Herb paints a lovely point, a lovely picture. I'm not so sure about the mutual benefit that the clinical and the general or non-clinical parts of the program are supposed to have. I don't know how it, of course, I haven't been around in the last few years. I think that there is a great benefit to be had, but I'm not sure that it's as a rule, exploited by the students or the faculty.
Why is that? They can't hold their wine, that's why.
I think the fact is that, in the first place, that a great many clinical students are here in a way as a trade school and not for scientific development.
In order to just to get a piece of paper.
Well, that's putting it hard.
Okay.
In order to get some basic qualifications to practice, and of course to get a piece of paper. But at any rate, I'd describe the orientation as essentially what's called psychodynamic, psychoanalytic. More or less psychoanalytic, with some exceptions. I have the impression that recently it's become more eclectic. Just tonight, a student in my seminar described it as eclectic. I'm not sure whether that's accurate or not. I think I'd still say that the that the major orientation for most of the students I've encountered is psychoanalytic. That's what the students are interested in, on the whole. And I have to divert them a little bit from that that interest with my because my attitude is, when I'm among psychoanalytic people, to criticize. And when I'm among those who are critical of psychoanalysis, to defend it.
So, on balance, which side do you favor?
I favor the psychoanalytic side.
I thought so.
Yeah.
Jeremy?
Well, I suppose I have the, in some respects, the, you know, in terms of commenting on what the nature of the program is now, I have the benefit of having been director of clinical psychology. More recently, I came here in 1993, as Michael said, did a 3-year term then and did a 3 or 4 year term that recently ended in 2009. And so I've seen the program go through a lot of changes. The program, when I came here, was very much of a psychoanalytic program. When I came here, I think really tried to sort of maintain that orientation, but at the same time build up, this has nothing to do with theoretical orientation, but more of an emphasis on the integration of research and practice, the scientist-practitioner model, which is central to clinical psychology, the idea being that you know, students who are clinical psychologists will basically use their clinical experience to help them do clinically meaningful research, and that their research will feed back into the clinical practice. So I try to maintain that psychoanalytic legacy while emphasizing more of the scientist-practitioner model, which I really sort of strongly endorse and believe in and was mentored in, and which is also, in a sense, a sort of a mandate for clinical psychology within North America. In terms of a psychoanalytic orientation, I think at this point in time, Herb, David, myself, and Miriam, the current director of clinical psychology, can all be described as broadly psychoanalytic. I think there are similarities and differences. There are different schools within psychoanalysis. without going into detail, I think Herb is, from my perspective, represents a certain sort of tradition of psychoanalysis, which was really sort of at the leading edge when he was trained. David has his own unique vision of a psychoanalysis that was strongly influenced by some of his own experiences and the mentors he worked with that he can talk about when we get to that question, but both of them would broadly be spoken about as belonging to the sort of ego-psychological tradition, whereas my emphasis is more of what is currently referred to as a relational psychoanalytic tradition. And we can talk about similarities and differences later on. I think one similarity between Herb, David, and myself that many of the students have noted and which I agree with is that we all, regardless of our particular orientations, have very much of a strong emphasis on focusing on what's actually happening in the room rather than letting our theories guide us too much. So the idea is to hold theory lightly. Now, the final thing that I would add is that when I became director of clinical psychology for the second term, I started initiating a more kind of pluralistic emphasis to the program for a number of reasons. Number one, although I'm strongly committed to psychoanalysis and believe that it has had a very important influence on our culture and can continue to, The reality is that psychoanalysis has become increasingly marginalized within our culture, and the cognitive behavioral tradition has become the dominant tradition. Number two, I think all schools of psychotherapy have something to teach us. So I felt it was very important for our students to be educated in at least two orientations, to both learn the basics of psychoanalysis, but to also learn more about cognitive therapy, which is really the dominant tradition. And so I think probably the major shift in the last few years is that some of the basic courses at the beginning are more cognitive behavioral, and at the same time, students are getting more of a psychoanalytic orientation as well. And one of the major shifts I've seen in just the last 5 years, which has been shocking to me, is that when I first came here, students were very critical of the cognitive therapy orientation. Whereas now, when I start teaching them psychoanalysis in the second or third year, they start off often feeling skeptical of psychoanalysis. And hopefully, in time, they come around to seeing the value of both approaches. So I think there has been a move towards more of a pluralistic perspective. But I think that also sort of reflects what's, number one, I think of, you know, sort of value in terms of really having theoretical breadth and being able to work the wide range of problems. But at the same time, I think there's a way in which, in order to sort of, the New School has always been a very unique place intellectually. But in order to be able to retain some contact with the mainstream, I think it's important for students to have some kind of understanding of what the dominant mainstream is, which is cognitive behavioral. So I think that's been an important shift.
Who was a man from Pennsylvania, from the University of Pennsylvania?
Aaron Beck.
Yes, Aaron Beck was on our program. Yeah. It was just sort of wonderful guest. Yeah. But that is now the dominant.
Yeah, it's cognitive therapy has become the dominant tradition, certainly in North America, and increasingly around the world. And, you know, I think there are strengths and weaknesses to the cognitive therapy tradition, but that is the reality. I think psychoanalysis has become increasingly marginalized, and I think that's unfortunate, and hopefully things will change.
Change back to psychoanalytic ideas, or change to what, something else? It becomes not marginalized, and they become of equal place, or?
Well, my perspective is that, and I don't want to go on too much length, but that what happened was that within North America especially, but other places as well, psychoanalysis originally began as a very kind of revolutionary, subversive tradition, culturally subversive tradition. Within many places, but especially in North America, over time it became a very sort of conservative tradition which embodied many of the values of sort of the cultural mainstream psychiatry and so on and so forth, and it became very rigid in a lot of ways. I think psychoanalysis became very insular, and as a result of that and a number of factors, it ultimately sort of lost its centrality. Part of it was the biological revolution which took place within psychiatry. I think as a result of that, psychoanalysis has become more marginalized, but with that marginalization, I think what's happened is that psychoanalysts in some sense are having to rethink what they're doing, and in many ways are becoming more open and flexible, and reacquiring some of the kind of subversive inquiring spirit, which I think we had at the very beginning. So my hope is that in time there will be a kind of rebalancing within the culture where psychoanalysis is able to influence the culture in a positive way.
So what would you say to those points?
I think they're overstated by a considerable margin. It depends what you mean by mainstream. I think most of the research money now goes to other kinds of treatment modes that can be specified more precisely, whether more effective or not. And certainly much more money is going to that, and there are many more programs in psychology going to that. Psychiatry has more or less given up on psychotherapy for a long time, of any kind. It costs too much to give and gets back too much too little. It's much more economical to spend 15 minutes with a patient for the same price as you get for an hour of psychotherapy, if you do it only drug monitoring.
On the other hand, many psychiatrists are getting very bored with doing that and are trying to get more training in psychotherapy. I think you have to ask, where do cognitive behavioral therapists go for their therapy? That's the answer.
Where do they go?
They don't go to other cognitive therapists. Yeah.
Well, I think it's a mistake. I think it's a mistake to try to weigh the two, to measure them this way, to measure their popularity. What Jeremy is talking about, I suppose, mostly is the popularity in university settings. There are different issues involved altogether. The simple fact is that psychodynamic thinking is more interesting than cognitive therapy. And by meaning by that, it's more respectful of the complications of the human life, of the mind. And for that reason, I think it's more interesting to students. I find it to be more interesting to the students that I encounter here, even now, after their what Jeremy describes as their training in cognitive therapy. So I don't doubt that it's true that strictly psychoanalytic therapy is diminishing. For practical reasons, it's expensive. I think partly for reasons of its own making. I think psychoanalysis had become too rigid in certain respects. Theoretically, in my opinion, backward in certain respects. But the basic ideas of internal conflict and of people of self-deception, people not knowing themselves. These things exist, and they'll continue to exist, and they'll continue to be of interest, even if nobody signs up for psychoanalytic treatment. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's clearly true, but I mean, I'm the layman here, so, but I mean, my question would be, if clearly there are issues, I mean, why wouldn't you seek out, why does there have to be one dominant way of approaching an understanding of the conflicts within us? I mean, I would want to know everything that science could teach me, science in terms of biological science. I would want to know everything that cognitive therapy could teach me. I would want to know everything that psychoanalysis could teach me. I mean, because it's my understanding of self which is at stake.
Good point. When I came here to find that the atmosphere or the point of view sort of as it was psychoanalytic, I knew one didn't have to do much to encourage that. New York was a hotbed of psychoanalysis. And there were...
And cultural figures were giving it great promotion.
Right, and I was a card-carrying member of two of the organizations in the city. And it did indeed more of that. I was concerned about bringing more of the biological point of view,
right,
particularly neuropsychology,
right,
to the department, feeling that was the only area of psychology that was exclusively psychological, that no other field had a claim on, whereas anybody and his kid sister can do psychotherapy, providing they've got enough nerve and a quiet place to do it. so that was one of my main things I wanted to build. And the other was to make sure that the training was all it could be, because when I first came here, it seemed that it was a rather Darwinian approach. Students are left pretty much on their own to find their own training experiences, their own externships. They had to get clinical experience wherever they could. And there was no way to vet that for quality. And we were mandated to have a clinic here, which I think would have been a disaster. Not because a clinic wouldn't be a good thing to have, but the kind of clinics that get built by universities are for educational purposes. And they're only open during academic years. They're not connected with hospitals, and they don't deal with emergencies. and pretty soon you're dealing with a sophomore girl who's lost a boyfriend is the dominant problem they have to deal with. Now, New York is surrounded with mental health facilities, you see, and also surrounded by therapists. My thought was, if you had an anxiety attack on Fifth Avenue and 14th Street, you'd be trampled to death by therapists. That'd be the big trouble. So the question was how to get the existing mental health agencies, the various South Beach ones, the various hospitals the people are training at now, to agree to take our students and to give them a vetted experience. Right. That is to take on the responsibility of training the series to become adjunct faculty members of our own group here to obtain the honorific titles that go with it, which were very desirable, and to make sure that the people who did our supervision were qualified to do it. And as far as I know, that system has remained in place. I visited every one of them to make sure it did. And that was very impressive because I'd never seen a faculty member before in most places. But the main idea was to make sure that what we did was of high quality and that it represented the dominant points of view at the time. Now, this was halfway through the third psychiatric revolution, before people discovered that pills didn't do exactly what they were supposed to do most of the time. And before psychiatry dropped out of doing psychotherapy. So I'll turn this over to my colleagues here because they are more conversant with the...
Well, I mean, the first part of your, or the question you actually asked, I suppose, why wouldn't we want to, be familiar with a variety of different approaches? And, my perspective is, the more familiarity we have with different approaches, the better. I'm very much against insularity. I think it's very important to really be aware of all the different possibilities and to bring different perspectives to bear upon things. In terms of what Herb is saying about the situation when he came and, his emphasis on establishing excellent clinical training experiences that were not part of a university clinic, that's very interesting for me to hear. Certainly, what I know is that when I came here, Herb had done a wonderful job of assembling a really broad range of externship training experiences for students across the larger New York area. And I think the training they were getting there was excellent. At the same time, when I was brought here in 1993, the program was under a certain pressure from the American Psychological Association to do various things. One had to do with ensuring that we had sort of quality control over the clinical training, and the other was to place more of an emphasis on integrating our clinical training with research training. And despite the fact that students were getting research training from psychologists in general psychology, many of them top-rate psychologists, the issue really is that, learning how to integrate research with clinical work in some kind of a meaningful way is very difficult to do unless you're really sort of exposed to mentors who are doing that, who are both clinicians and researchers, or unless you're in settings where those two are, those two things are done. So what became very clear to me when I was initially interviewed for the position was I felt that in order to achieve what the American Psychological Association required of us and also to achieve what I thought was a very important mission for us, I thought we needed to have more control over our clinical training. So I remember at the time speaking with the president at the time, Jonathan Fanton, and saying, well, when I come, what's going to be critical is that we're allowed to develop our own clinic. So quite the opposite of Herb, but I guess the times have changed. But the idea was that by developing our own clinic, we would be able to have more control over quality control of clinical training and making sure that students were able to integrate research and practice. And at the time, the president, Jonathan Fanton, said, sure, well, give me a proposal, we'll look at it, et cetera, et cetera. So I wrote a proposal, and then I got here after taking the position and found out that the administration was not willing to invest the money in setting up such a clinic. And there's a certain amount of resistance to setting up that kind of a clinic within the department itself. But I managed, as a result of a number of different fortunate circumstances, to work out a collaboration with Beth Israel Medical Center, where we set up a clinical training center, which both provided clinical training that we were able to have more control over, in addition to the excellent externship experiences that our students were already getting, and also were able to expose students to an more of an integration of clinical practice and research. So I think that's probably been another shift in the model that's taken place.
Let me ask this question. I mean, we've talked a lot about the process here, and let's assume that there are five great programs that teach clinical psychology, doctorate programs in clinical psychology. I remember, I'm a lawyer by training, and you know, forgive me for that. So, but they used to be said in this sort of cute little definition that at Yale Law School, they taught you what the law should be. At Harvard, they taught you what the law was. And that was a basic distinction between the two. And that Yale, Harvard lawyers became lawyers, and Yale lawyers became professors and other things. Is there a battle raging in clinical psychology today about what ought to be taught? And are universities sort of having to decide what field they want to play in?
I would say yes. There's a definite battle being raged. It's a battle which has almost been won. And basically,
by those who teach cognitive therapy is the way to go.
Yeah, by those who teach cognitive therapy and by those who emphasize the fact that any therapy that is taught is therapy that has to be validated according to certain empirical criteria.
All right. So let me ask this. Do you have a dog in this hunt, David?
I think it's necessary to recognize that there's a significant division between the people in academic psychology and the people who practice.
What's the difference?
Cognitive therapy has certainly won the battle, if there has been a battle.
Now, is that because of results they achieve?
That's arguable. I mean, results are not easy to validate and estimate in our field. But I'm not sure that it is simply a matter of results. I mean, there's a structural problem in our field that consists of the following, in my opinion. In order to get an academic position, one has to start. One has to apply for such a position and begin academic work rather soon after one gets a degree. That means that the people who are teaching, on the whole, have rather little clinical experience. The place where cognitive therapy has won the battle is in academic life. In private practice, I don't know. I don't. It's much.
It's a very good question, though. Do you have an opinion on that, Herb?
Yeah, I think it's a complicated one, but I think I'd answer that the cognitive therapists have won pretty much also on the basis of results. If I saw somebody who had a simple phobia, I wouldn't send him to an analyst. See? I'd send him to a cognitive behavioral therapist. See? If I had other kinds of simple, relatively simple symptom-based troubles, they can be dealt with rather quickly through this much less intensive and much less demanding method. it used to be a fixture of psychoanalytic belief that it didn't pay to do that because if you tampered with a symptom, it would pop up someplace else. It's like a matrix spring, you know. You push down one coil, it goes up place else. It doesn't happen. See, that's simply not true. One can deal with these things quite separately, and for the most part, they don't return. People are happy.
That's not true, of course.
As you see, if I said something else, he would have defended me.
But there are analysts and analysts. There are plenty of analysts. I wouldn't send such a person to either, or anyone else, for that matter. But it's not an open and shut case, even with the kind of patients that you spoke of.
Well, I haven't finished my discourse, but go ahead.
finish your discourse.
No, I think this is more interesting.
No, it's
finish your discourse.
Go ahead.
No. The rest of it would be that the symptom pictures rarely occur in isolation. See. And not infrequently, somebody who comes with a problem like that and gets it fixed finds that there are other things he'd like to have fixed as well, that there is a systemic aspect to all these things. One didn't break out in this rash of anxiety just now. What are other reasons? It could have happened any time. So that by and large, one finds out that the person has a symptom generator, not just a symptom. And for that, a more thoroughgoing therapy is called for. But I would deal with the first one first and let the patient find that out. I agree. There are a lot of people I wouldn't send a dog to, including some veterinarians.
Yeah. If I can just say a little bit about the issue of, you know, has cognitive therapy won on the basis of having shown results? I think what really complicates the situation is that psychotherapy is more difficult to do research on than you know, sort of medication or surgical procedures. And, you know, results in psychotherapy or what counts as results in psychotherapy has a lot to do with values. And so psychotherapy is an inherently more difficult enterprise to do research on than medicine, let's say. So I think that what's happened is, first of all, cognitive therapists have won the battle in the universities and among and within granting agencies, because from the beginning they decided that they were going to do research, whereas psychoanalysts always turned up their noses at the idea of doing research. Number two, because it's easier to do research if you conceptualize psychotherapy in very simplistic terms. So I think for those reasons, cognitive therapy was able to establish itself as an effective treatment. Psychoanalysts were very sort of slow to rise to the challenge and to start doing research on psychoanalysis. In the last 15 or 20 years, there has been a lot of empirical research demonstrating that at least short-term dynamic therapy is as effective, if not more effective, than short-term cognitive therapy. It's harder to do research on long-term psychoanalysis for all sorts of practical reasons. But it's taken psychoanalysts a long time to sort of put the energy into that effort. And now there are huge political factors which make it difficult, even though there is that evidence, to convince people of the fact that that evidence is meaningful. Okay, the second point that I would make is that because psychoanalysis in general really sort of tends to be less kind of target focused and less has less of an emphasis on immediate practical results and more of an emphasis on sort of broader values such as quality of life and meaning and so on and so forth, it is more difficult to do meaningful research. So I think that's why it's more difficult to do research on psychoanalysis and long-term psychoanalysis. The final thing that I would say is that there is a lot of, as a psychotherapy researcher, I can say that there's a lot of misinterpretation of what the research really shows. Cognitive therapists will argue that the research shows that cognitive therapy is the most effective treatment. Many researchers who are not cognitive therapists or even open-minded cognitive therapists will argue that what the research actually shows is that there is no difference in the effectiveness of different kinds of therapy. What accounts for what makes a difference are issues such as the therapeutic relationship, the particular sort of qualities that the therapist has, and various so-called non-specific factors that have nothing to do with specific brand of therapy. The major factor that seems to be related to whether or not one therapy is demonstrated to be more effective than others seems to be the allegiance of the researcher. So cognitive therapists tend to find that cognitive therapy is more effective. Psychodynamically oriented researchers tend to find that psychodynamic approaches are more effective. If there's one effect that has emerged as being particularly robust over time, it's that. It's the allegiance of the researcher. So what are derogatorily referred to as sort of horse race studies by many psychotherapy researchers, although they can demonstrate that one form of therapy is better than another form of therapy, other researchers argue that that's essentially not what they really demonstrate and that that's not what's going to be helpful to us in terms of figuring out how best to help people.
All right, let me go back to the question. So the five best schools for teaching clinical psychology today, do they all have the same approach? Have they all bought into cognitive therapy, or is there a great debate going on, and is it sort of, if you took five as your sample, where would you end up?
I have no idea.
I don't either. all right, so my next, so what's the role of a university administration here? I mean, so suppose you're running the department, are you, you know, what is the, so what should you be doing with your program? You don't understand the question?
No.
Okay. let's assume I'm the dean of the School of Clinical Psychology, right? What's my responsibility in terms of creating a curriculum that best trains clinical psychologists to most effectively achieve, maximize professional results? What's the curriculum? What's the approach? What's the, you know, because you've just explained to me that there's a great division within the community.
I think the dean stays clear of that.
No,
he can speak for.
Well, no. You know, I was actually thinking about that. He ought to be up here, and I should be sitting out there.
I think David is right. I think there is a split between what is taught in the universities and what takes place in the real world.
So is that good or bad?
And that's really problematic.
That's a problem.
Yeah.
I never heard Dean say that to me.
Never said what? Did I? What I just asked?
What the hell are you doing?
Would you be insulted if he did? Or?
No, I'd be happy to talk.
Exactly. That's what I would think, too. Yeah. I mean, what's the best way for us to achieve our mission?
When I found when I came here that I was to be the Alfred J. Marrow and Monet C. Right. Marrow Professor of Psychology, and I had to, they gave me a dowry,
yeah.
$40,000 that went with that.
Right.
And I had to give a talk to the assembled multitude explaining what I was doing. I gave a talk saying, Soft Science for Hard Times, that was the title. Covered most of the kind of things we're talking about here.
So I want to turn this over to this audience and for more informed and smarter questions. But where is brain science in all of this? The kind of stuff that I'm doing a program about, because we are seeing in every episode. I mean, we've talked about, for example, you know, the visual perception. We've talked about the developing brain and the emotional brain and the, you know, the aging brain and all of this stuff. And I know. You know, and we've obviously looked at the genetic and the aspects of this. We've obviously looked at the increasing ability to look at the brain and for localized function, you know, and all of the kind of imaging today gives us, and that is proceeding at a velocity that is quite amazing, as all of you know.
Yeah.
That's one idea. Now, the other thing that always strikes me that I've learned from this process, and I'm I'm here knowing nothing. It is that, in a very interesting way, science, brain science, is showing how some of the people who were really forerunners, without the ability and without the tools, were right. You know, it's extraordinary in terms of how they're, through psychoanalysis, through a whole range of other things, had been very smart.
Yeah.
In terms of understanding how the, psychology, psychoanalysis, how the brain works.
From my point of view, you picked up the most important issue facing us now. More and more is being learned about how the brain works.
Right.
Everything I learned in college about the brain is mostly wrong. I was taught it was in your head.
Right.
And since the head is encased in bone, the brain can't grow. It dies from the moment you're born.
Yeah, little cell by cell.
A little bit, one time.
Right.
It's absolutely wrong.
Exactly.
The brain does grow. And the plasticity of the brain
now
is the biggest thing, I think, on the horizon. And at our most recent analytic meeting in Columbia, we had Norman Deutsch talk to us about his book on the brain that changes itself, and showing the practical application of that kind of, that point of view in treating strokes and treating aphasia and treating all kinds of conditions where the brain can be helped to reprogram itself.
Yeah.
And that is a challenge for psychology, because the so-called neuropsychoanalysis movement is a very primitive one right now. And most of what's going on in brain science, to my mind, is also very primitive, showing that if you do something, something lights up in the brain.
Right.
What happens to the rest of it is of no interest,
exactly.
As long as it lights up. It's ridiculous.
I agree. All right, so
I think that's where we are, but it's up to, it'll be now, the dean will have to get after and say, what are you doing to take into account these new findings in science? And I hope
there
that time arrives soon.
All right, questions from this audience before we, yes?
So I'm coming from the neuroscience point of view, who's interested in neuropsychoanalytic ideas. And I wrote a paper for this journal, Neuropsychoanalysis, that's headed by Mark Solms, called The Neural Basis of the Dynamic Unconscious. And I got a lot of feedback from analysts about this, saying, you know, we really need to understand the neural basis of these phenomena. But so it's really a new field in neuroscience to come up with paradigms that we can look at experimentally to understand these phenomena in clinic. But the real thing is to get also feedback from the other side, to have from the analytic side to say, you know, how can we take these things we know that work in the clinic and subject them to scientific inquiry. And we really need to come at it from both sides. So we can use, Freud was a neuroscientist, and he really thought that all of his ideas were going to be instantiated in the brain. Maybe they didn't have the technology at the time to look at it, but now we're starting to get there. So I know what we can do from the neuroscientific point of view. We have neuroimaging, we have deep brain stimulation, we can now look at even electrodes, we can implant electrodes in human brains, we can record from human neurons. But how can we get from the psychoanalytic community, from the other side, sort of, what can they do to help with the scientific of these phenomena?
Well, you're not going to be overrun, I tell you, by volunteers. But there are any number of people now, younger ones particularly, who are interested in just those things and are working at it. We have the head of child psychiatry, who's also the head of our imaging service at Columbia, is an analyst, and being helped by psychiatrists who are also analysts who are interested in imaging. You know, they're secretly and quietly, these things are going on right now, and mostly by volunteers, and there's money available for it. But I think it's at a very, very beginning stage of it. It's not ready yet for prime time, that it's not ready to train somebody how to do something technically. It's all quite experimental still. And I think in the next 5 years, it'll be very different. But it's not too soon to start revamping the curriculum in our field.
What sort of thing do you have in mind when you speak of something coming from the other direction? What kind?
So, for instance, we look at paradigms, looking at things like repression and suppression and dissociation, and how can we measure it in an empirical way in the lab. So let's say, I've talked to analysts about this. They said, well, you know, it's just on an individual basis, so we can't do these group type experiments where we say, let's take a group of people and have them undergo psychoanalysis and then look at them before and after, and let's say do brain imaging before and after. They would say, well, it's only on an individual basis, so we can't look at them as a group and do the classic sort of experimental paradigm. So I think I personally felt resistance from the community in that respect. That's just one example.
You know,
go ahead.
if I can just say a couple of things, I think neuroscience research is extremely important, and my perception also is that many psychoanalysts are increasingly interested in neuroscience research. And I think that's a good thing for a lot of reasons. But I also agree, at least my colleagues who are neuroscientists tell me, that the state of the art is more primitive than popularizers of neurosciences tend to convey. My other concern is that the sort of one of the reasons that, let me put it this way, there's been a tremendous movement towards a kind of biological orientation in general in the field. And there is a way that people have a sense that if you're speaking about the biological level, then you have something tangible that you can grasp onto. And I have no doubt that the more we understand about all levels of analysis, the better. But by the same token, it's important to recognize that reductionism can be a problem. And part of what's happened in terms of funding from government agencies, well, there are two major developments. Number one, more and more of the funding is going towards funding biological research. And number two, the funding that is left over goes towards funding cognitive therapy research. I think that's problematic. I think that neuroscience is important. I think that biological research is important. But I think it's also important to recognize that there are many different levels of analysis and that it can't all be reduced down to the level of sort of neuroscience, even though you can find neuroscientific or neurobiological correlates to different psychological states.
Yes.
I just wanted to speak to the issue of the study that you're mentioning, because I actually think that they're doing that study at the Columbia, the Center for Psychoanalytic Research and Training, where they're actually doing brain imaging before analysis and then after analysis. Also, in the fourth year of analytic training there, they have a full year course on neurology and neuroanalysis. So that integration is happening in analytic training.
Repression is an idea that comes out of psychoanalysis. It fits a certain paradigm. But there are terms in both fields that are translatable, like memory, attention. See? Now, if you look at is repression a memory problem? Is an attention problem? We can think of it that way and find the concepts that one can really test empirically, it might not be repression as a clinician thinks about it, but the effect would be the same. How does one make something unavailable to consciousness? And again, consciousness is the big problem for all of us.
You can either comment on what the question or also on the response or add to it. I mean, anybody that wants to sort of, you know, just...
Well. I was given the microphone for...
We'll have a great level of interactivity. Yes?
Yeah, I was given the microphone for something maybe a little to the side of that.
Okay.
I come from the pre-Dr. Schlesinger Darwinian past of the program. And at the time, the force of natural selection was Mary Henley's History and Systems class. A few people smile because they remember that. And from that perspective, I just want to emphasize that we're still a very young discipline. All these battles we think we're winning, there's really no central paradigm that I think explains human behavior and human experience and consciousness. We're at the very, very early stages of psychological science. And all of these battles that are being fought from a clinician's point of view as a practicing psychoanalyst is that it enables patients to win the battle because we can keep our minds open to new techniques, to new involvements, to new ways of thinking about what's going on. So I'm really glad the academics are fighting these fights, but from a clinician's point of view, I'm glad there's no winner right now.
Yes.
One of the problems I have is that, and Dr. Safran alluded to it, is that it very much depends on the measurability of what you're looking at. It's much easier to measure specific symptoms of anxiety or depression than to measure the sense of personal agency somebody might have over doing what he does. You know, behaving in a way he wishes he didn't behave, he doesn't really know why he did it. So science will always, I think, kind of force results to gravitate towards that that can be measured most easily. And because the imprimatur of science culturally is so much greater now, it seems that anything that can't be measured easily just becomes marginalized necessarily, and anything that can't be reduced to individual units is that much harder to measure. And so, for instance, if you're looking at repression, that's a concept, it's an idea, but how it translates into the life of an actual person living, you know, in his actual life is questionable. I mean, I find it interesting from a theoretical standpoint, but I could see why a clinician really wouldn't care. So I'm just wondering if you, well, you agree with it because I see you're nodding your head, but what's to be done about it? Because without the science, there's, you know, insurance isn't going to pay for things, people aren't going to respect the field. So what's the next step then?
I think part of the problem, and I'm often asked to engage in these kinds of debates because I am both a researcher and a psychoanalyst, is that many psychoanalysts essentially say research is meaningless, so, you know, let's just throw up our hands and, you know, not really, you know, get our hands dirty or get involved in the discussion, and they become more insular. I think what's really critical is to train students. So in contrast, David had said that, a lot of students come here to learn to be clinical psychologists. That's true. And I think that's very valuable. But I also think it's important for us to train students who are really sort of exposed to different traditions and really have a sort of like a deep understanding of the philosophy of science so that they can then go back into academia and influence the kinds of conversations that take place in academia so that academics will develop a kind of broader perspective which recognizes the complexity of the kinds of issues that you're talking about. And that's not happening right now to the extent that it should, because there is such a split between researchers and clinicians.
Yes.
Hi, thanks. So I had the pleasure of hearing Jonathan Shedler present his article a couple weeks ago in Chicago, and it was very, very compelling. Granted, I was in a room with a bunch of analysts, you know, and I'm a biased listener, but, you know, it was compelling and it was really encouraging. And so I'm wondering if, you know, is this sort of like a mass delusion, or are we just so, what's the response?
Oh, look, Jonathan Shedler is an old friend of mine. We taught together at Adelphi University. I know that article very well. It took him 4 or 5 years to get it published in American Psychologist, precisely because of the fact that he had to sort of fight against the political odds to get it published, because he was really assembling the evidence that psychodynamic therapy works. It has now been published, and what's happening is that the critiques are starting to come out, written by cognitive therapists, saying that it's flawed in a variety of different ways because the studies included in the meta-analyses are methodologically flawed, et cetera, et cetera. So in return, what's happening is that the more psychoanalytically oriented researchers are responding and saying, well, wait a second, you're applying double standards, because the studies that are typically entered into cognitive therapy meta-analyses are just as methodologically flawed. So I think that's the kind of debate which is taking place, which is, you know, which is very natural. But I think, you know, the fact that he was able to get that published in American Psychologist was a very important beginning, but it's just a beginning.
If I may, I will speak. I will speak from the point of a physician, oncologist, and nuclear medicine physician. And I must say that as a physician, we say that there are functional disturbances and organic disturbances, if you wish. So I think in cases where a real intervention, maybe even intervention with drugs is required, then the imaging and new biological methods and diagnostic methods will really take place. But in terms of where we're talking about consciousness and very, very minor, very, I would say, intelligent type of disturbances, then the personal approach, psychodynamic approach, whatever you call it, will take a leading role. I have a question to our guests. How those achievements in research has influenced your own practice as psychoanalyst, as a therapist within this last, 30, 40 years?
By research, you mean psychological research?
Yes, yeah. And biological research.
And biological research. I think the truth is virtually not at all. there's a problem, I think, with clinical research. I'm speaking now about neuropsychological research. That's something separate. Clinical research, meaning by that statistical, quantitative research, is, in my opinion, generally in the field of clinical psychology, not strong. It's very weak. It's inconclusive. The typical study, at least within my experience, and my experience in academic life is not my whole career, but within my experience, typically, the results of the statistical research are vague. People discuss, well, this statistical result can be understood this way. Somebody else says it can be understood that way. I don't know of any. If I were asked for a single example of the application of such research to leaving apart cognitive therapy. Apart from cognitive therapy, I can't think of a single example of where such research has influenced psychodynamic therapy. And I'd be interested if anyone else could think of a single example.
I have two.
I'm very much in favor of research. But I think research of a different kind, namely a case study, intensive study of individuals, and I think that kind of research will help us understand more about psychopathology, and understanding more about psychopathology is bound to influence psychotherapy. I think that's true in general. If I think back about my own experience, I think the fact that for a number of years I did a lot of Rorschach testing influenced my understanding of psychopathology. Rorschach testing is non-historical work. It doesn't involve the patient's history. It involves the working of the present personality. That was influential in my therapeutic work, and I can imagine more research in psychopathology that might be of that sort. But that's the result of study of a great many individual ways of thinking and ways of looking at ink blots. And that seems to me quite different from the sort of research that students do. In fact, it's been a regret of mine to see the amount of time and ingenuity that students spend in research that it's not at all likely to be influential, and not likely to be conclusive.
Yeah, when you survey clinicians in the field, the majority of them will say the same thing as David, which is that research influences their practice very little, and certainly a lot less more, or rather a lot less than clinical supervision, theory, et cetera, et cetera. And I also agree with David that a lot of the research which is done does not provide sort of meaningful information for the clinician who has to decide how to respond to this particular patient in this particular moment, because the research takes place at such a global level. For all that, I think that research serves as a useful counterbalance to a purely theoretically driven orientation towards the field, which argues on the basis of authority and rhetoric. The final thing I would say about that is I think you need to distinguish between the kind of there are many different research paradigms that have developed, and you have to distinguish between the traditional psychoanalytic case history, which really involves sort of a narrative which is constructed by the clinician, versus a more intensive individual case analysis that really involves looking at things from multiple perspectives. And I think that kind of research, and many psychotherapy researchers would agree, has more of a possibility of yielding information that's useful to the clinician.
One more question before we close out tonight. Didn't I say yes, sir?
It seems that whenever the discussion of psychotherapy and science comes up, you inevitably come to this sort of conundrum where what is being studied isn't necessarily what's being implemented, and what's being implemented isn't necessarily being studied. And as I think sort of Jeremy was sort of alluding to, that, but not pointing his finger at directly, is that the conversation inevitably comes to what can be known, how can it be known, what can be measured, what can't be measured. So it becomes a question of the philosophy of science. And so I'm wondering from any of the three of you, if you can sort of respond to the question of where is the role of the philosophy of science in the contemporary or the next clinical psychology curriculum?
I think it's critically important. I think that as a rule, clinical psychology students are not well educated in the philosophy of science. I think a lot of the research which is done in not just clinical psychology, but psychology in general, is really sort of shaped by a kind of sort of logical positivist framework, which is very much outdated within the philosophy of science. So I think it's really critical for clinical psychologists to have a much better grounding in the philosophy of science and to really sort of understand alternative paradigms and some of the more contemporary developments in the philosophy of science. I think that's a huge deficit in the curricula of most clinical psychology programs.
David.
I'm afraid I was a philosophy major and a science major, but I'm not quite sure what he means by introducing the.
I think Sigmund Freud made an important contribution from the domain of psychology to the philosophy of science by hypothesizing that there was more to the phenomena of the individual that was immediately perceptible. He also, one of the drawbacks of that approach, of course, is that he introduced a lot of unmeasurable constructs. Gordon Allport also made a significant contribution by making the emphasis on ideographic approaches to understanding the individual as opposed to purely nomothetic approaches. Most of psychology research has been nomothetic. Most of psychiatry research has been nomothetic. B.F. Skinner probably made the last most important contribution by saying, why are we spending so much time trying to measure things that don't exist? Why not just look at the organism and its environment? Those currents, I think, are pervasive in the field, but in my own education in psychology in the New School, there wasn't really one single course that sort of addressed them as a generalized philosophy of science and asking the question, where are we going next? And what's contingent upon the people who are in the program now to what are the questions that we need to be asking next so that we can do better research on psychoanalysis, for example, so that we can better integrate neuroscience and behavior?
I remember many, you remind me, many years ago, I went to an APA meeting which was addressed by Robert Oppenheimer. Do you remember that?
Yes, yes, indeed.
I think the two of us are there.
There are a lot of other people there, too.
And I remember Oppenheimer warning psychologists, don't imitate the methods of physics. They won't work. Adapt your methods to your field. It seems to me that has not happened in clinical psychology.
Agreed.
His speech was entitled "Analogy in Science," and it's available. And it's a must-read. By the way, I would agree, by and large, with David here on the lack of utility of much of what comes out in research. There are two ideas that did come out of research that I think I've applied. One of those came out of Lester Laborsky's work showing that of all the factors influencing the outcome in psychotherapy, the relationship with the therapist was probably the most profound one. And the second one, come out more recently, I think out of Canada, Fenelim Azim, and it's been replicated recently, showing that excessive interpretation turns patients off. Since both of those agree with my own position, I've adopted them very easily.
On that note, thanks very much to Herb Schlesinger, David Shapiro.
Thank you, everyone, for coming out this evening, and another round of applause for Charlie Rose for agreeing to moderate.